Okay, good morning to the hallowed small number that turned up for this session. I'm not worried, I can see a lot of experts in the room that can make this session a success. We're also very lucky to have three excellent speakers. My name's Paul Greenhalf from the University of Nottingham. I think the integration of fuel use during exercise or even at rest and what controls it is still a huge topic of controversy, and we're still not clear if there is a key regulator of fuel selection. However, in the opinion of some of us in the room, we very much believe that carnitine does play a key role. It's the only metabolite in muscle that actually has a central role in both carbohydrate and lipid oxidation, and therefore it has a it's located at the crossroads of fuel selection. So the way this morning will run, we will start off with a overview of the topic of limitations to fat oxidation in muscle from Jørn Hell from the University of Copenhagen, who's worked in this area for many years. We'll then move to Stefan Krabel from University of Basel, who will talk about the impact of reducing carnitine in muscle. And then finally, we'll have Francis Stevens, I nearly said from the University of Nottingham there, but actually he's been at the University of Exeter for a year now, who will focus on increasing muscle carnitine content. So thank you very much. One last point, there will be time for questions, but please go to the microphone because this session is being streamed by the college and we want to be able to hear your questions at the end. Thank you very much, and I'd like to bring the first speaker, Jørn, to the stage.
So, thank you, Paul. I'd just like to thank the college for the invitation to come here and present on this topic. It's a challenge. I haven't actually spoken on this topic for a few years, and the chairman is, as you know, very knowledgeable on this. So I'll try to give you some my take on what is the mechanistic limitations to the attenuation of fat oxidation shifting from moderate to high intensity exercise. These are my conflicts of interest, some consulting work and some collaboration, and it shouldn't have any influence on what I say today. So just a brief background. We are all aware that fat oxidation is influenced by many factors. Exercise intensity is one of the key ones, which is the focus of today, but also duration of exercise, training status, whether you are fed or fasted, and also whether you actually consume a given substrate during exercise. The surroundings, temperature, altitude will have an influence on fat oxidation, the exercise mode. Gender obviously also being a parameter, and then the dietary intake prior to the exercise that we are undertaking. So these are factors, but the main focus today is exercise intensity. These are data from Henrik Galbo published in the early 90s, and it's taken actually from data that was generated in the late 30s out of Copenhagen, Christensen and Hansen's data. And as evident here, you see an increase in oxygen uptake across the x-axis, and you see the fat combustion or oxidation, if you wish, in kilocalories per minute. And as evident, you see that this has some sort of a bell shape, or at least with a peak somewhere, and here it's apparent at 60% approximately of VO2 max. And then after that, there's a decrease in fat oxidation as exercise intensity is increased. And mainly the focus today, as already alluded to, is what is causing this? What are the mechanisms that we know today is actually causing this? There's been a lot of focus and debate on this issue, and this is a crossover concept that was published in mid-90s by Brooks and Mercier. And not to go through crossover concept at all, but just to reiterate it, obviously, when we speak about fat oxidation, obviously the flip side of the coin is carbohydrate oxidation, and these are two obviously integrating and has to be seen together. So this is the point. Not so interesting where they're actually crossed, but interesting is what are the mechanisms. So I will not deal any further with this crossover concept, just mention that it's there. So this is a representation of kinseline, and basically here you have the oxidation, and this is primarily in this talk focused on muscle, which is the key organ for oxidation during exercise. And here you have the exogenous substrates, the fat from VLDL triglyceride and from plasma long-chain fatty acids, albumin born, and then you have the glucose, obviously. And then on the inside of the muscle, you have the two endogenous stores, the muscle triglycerides and the glycogen. And with the transport into the muscle and then the transport into the mitochondria on the fat side and on the carbohydrate side, and then they converge beta oxidation to the acetyl-CoA or via the PDC into acetyl-CoA. They unite and converge on the TCA cycle and then finally are oxidized and ATP generated from the electron transport chain in the inner mitochondrial membrane. So basically where in this scheme do we have the mechanistic limitation? So this is the focus of the next 10 to 12 minutes talk. One of the most cited studies in this area is a study by Romain that came out in 93, where he depicts energy utilization and in cals per kg per minute, and then on three separate days tested three exercise intensity, 25, 65, and 85. And here you see a depiction of the utilization of exogenous and not just endogenous substrate stores. And as obviously know that as exercise intensity progresses, energy utilization is higher, which is a no-brainer. But the interesting aspect here, what is the distribution between the exogenous and endogenous and also the fat and carbohydrate? And it's slightly easier to see if you divide this graph and then look on the fat and the carbohydrate separately. And it's quite evident and agreed upon that the utilization of carbohydrate just increases with exercise intensity, and this both for the exogenous plasma glucose, also glycogen. For the fat, it's less agreed upon. So here you see that there's a peak at 65, obviously only with three intensities it is there. And you see that there's a slight decrement here in the utilization of plasma fatty acids, and there seems to be a peak on the intramuscular triglycerides, which actually also here includes the VLDL triglycerides, but that is probably, in most situations, not more than 2 to 3% of total turnover at the most. So probably negligible in most cases. But here you see there's a peak. There's some discussion about the distribution between these things, but clearly that has also an influence on the mechanisms that we are looking at. So what is driving this decrease over here? I think one of the important studies, and obviously I can only show you a few of the basal studies that actually are behind the mechanism here. One of them is Hans Romein, a study of 95, where they exercised young, very well-trained men on two conditions, either where they had a control day in the black circles up here, or where they did lipid heparin infusion. They exercised at 85% of U2max, so very high exercise intensity. As you can see, and not surprising, plasma fatty acids decrease without lipid heparin infusion, and increases to a very, very high level up here, almost to the toxic levels of fatty acids. And if you look on the what happens to oxidation and rate of appearance of fatty acids, it's quite evident that the rate of appearance is obviously higher with the lipid infusion, but also important to say that fat oxidation is actually increased during high-intensity exercise, as there is a higher plasma fatty acid delivery. And if we take the liberty, which also the authors do, to compare the amount of fat oxidizes expressed per kg per minute, you can see that it's slightly higher here when you have lipid infusion compared to the control situation. On a separate paper published before that with similar subjects under similar conditions using the same methods, they found that at 65% of U2max, they had an oxidation of fat at 43, which indicates to me that the shift from moderate to high intensity exercise only part of the fat oxidation is achieved when you increase the plasma fatty acid delivery by a very, very large margin, indicating that that plasma fatty acid delivery has a role in the limitation of maximal fat oxidation, but probably not a very large role. And further evidence that this role is not very, very high is the study that came out of Bente Kien's lab in just 1999. It was collaboration with Gerhard van der Wusse, where they studied on consecutive exercise at 65, 40 minutes, and then 90% VO2 max, 15 minutes with a short break with for biopsies in between. And apparently what they see is they see a decrease in plasma fatty acids as they progress from moderate to high intensity exercise. Then they also measured the availability of long-chain fatty acid in the muscle. And then this is not trivial, it is actually very difficult. And there are only, I think, only one or two papers in the literature that's actually done that. And over here you see the long-chain acyl-CoA content within the muscle. And the open bars are the amount in the homogenates, and the striped bars are where they've actually tried to subtract the extracellular long-chain fatty acids within the muscle tissue. And as you can see, shifting from moderate to high-intensity exercise, there's an increase in the availability of intramuscular long-chain fatty acids. And this would indicate that there's an increase in the availability, probably induced by a decrease in the mitochondrial fatty oxidation. So this would imply that it's not a limitation factor of the availability of the long-chain fatty acyl CoA that is actually behind this. Again, speaking the fact that the delivery is probably not a major factor in the mechanistic attenuation of fat oxidation, shifting from 65 to 90% of VO2 max, so moderate to high intensity exercise. Two other studies that I like to focus on here, they are early studies. So this is a study by Ken Salin, where he did exercise at three exercise intensities, 40, 75, and 100%, and measured the carnitine and the acetylcarnitine. And as exercise intensity progresses, you can see there's an increase in acetylcarnitine and a decrease in carnitine. And obviously, this would attenuate the ability to transport long-chain fatty acid into the mitochondria and may be part of the reason. So this is one of the important studies, I think. Another important study is out of Erik Hultmann's lab, Tim Constantine's work. And here, basically, you see on the lower part, you see the same picture with the free carnitine and acetylcarnitine. But what you also see here is that the coenzyme A and the acetyl-CoA ratio is also fluctuating, so that there is an increase in acetyl-CoA and a decrease in coenzyme A. And obviously, this would have an influence on the activation of the long-chain fatty acid and probably also be a limiting factor for fat oxidation. You see here also that there is an activation of PDC, and also, as quite apparent and expected, working at 90% of VO2 max, an increase in lactate. So I think these two studies are essential for the fact that the free carnitine could be a limiting factor. That's been developed further since then, and also that the coenzyme A has a role to play. More recent work from the chairman's laboratory, published by Ben Walls, 2013, I think it was published, takes this a little bit further in terms of the coenzyme A, and it's a very elegant argument. That the argument is that if you look on the oxidation of medium-chain fatty acids compared to long-chain fatty acids, you're probably aware that the medium-chain fatty acid can be transported across the mitochondria without problems, doesn't need a transporter. And when you look on high-intensity exercise, there's not a limitation here on the medium chain, but there is a limitation on the long-chain fatty acids. And this would indicate that the role of coenzyme A is actually proximal to the limitation of this transport. So the authors suggest that the major effect of the coenzyme A is actually intramitochondria, where also the largest pool is, and therefore they suggest that the effect of coenzyme A is actually on the CPT2, which will also attenuate the ability to transport long-chain fatty acid over the mitochondria and would have an attenuation of the maximal fat oxidation. Further support for this role is the reference to a manuscript that indicates that coenzyme A is actually not transported across the mitochondrial membrane. So I think there's some support for this. So summing up from where I am now, we can see that the decreased plasma fatty acid availability is probably not a major determinant. And then during heavy exercise, ADP increases glycolysis. Then we have acidosis and carnitine. Carnitine decreases, that would influence CPT1 activity, the transport decrease, and then that would reduce lipid oxidation. The other mechanism being an increase in acetyl-CoA, a decrease in coenzyme A, which means that less activation, meaning an effect on the ACS activity, meaning then again reduced lipid oxidation. So these are the two later bullet points, with the addition that they're probably the coenzyme A is on the intermitochondrial side rather than on the cytosolic side of things, and it is on CPT2. So basically, these are three of the mechanisms, with the two later bullet points being by far the most important. Then there's a further addition to this topic, and I think these are elegant theories put forward by Ken Salim primarily, and not really well supported if you look on direct evidence, but the theoretical framework is quite clear. One of the issues here is obviously that when we do high intensity exercise, there's an effect on the energy state in the muscle. The AMP-ATP ratio changes, the ADP-ATP ratio changes. And this only influences the carbohydrate side of things. It does not influence the oxidation and transport or the early part of the fat side. So it doesn't influence beta oxidation, doesn't influence acetyl-CoA into oxidative phosphorylation. This would mean that probably the influence here on low energy state would primarily have an effect on the carbohydrate side, and then that would probably, via the NADH, actually have a possibility to decrease beta oxidation and be one of the mechanisms. And to take that even further, if you look on the inner mitochondrial membrane, if you look on the fat oxidation, whereas on the carbohydrate side, the NADH from the carbohydrate oxidation is only feeding into complex 1, and this is the mitochondrial membrane, we have the inner space here and the outer space here, you can see that whereas oppositely, the oxidation of fatty acids is actually contributing, reducing equivalence into the complex 1 and complex 2. So the difference here being the FAD. And if there is a difference in high intensity exercise, either on the balance between these two, the ratios of these two, or there is a depletion of the coenzyme Q, which is the intermediate point here where the complex 1 and complex 2 converges, then that would actually provide a framework where we could actually have an attenuation of fat oxidation moving from moderate to high intensity exercise, which could be driven by effects on redox effect on the inner mitochondrial membrane. So that is a plausible explanation. There is some evidence for this, but not really very strong evidence. But it is, as in my opinion, one of the possible mechanisms that could actually regulate this shift. So basically, the first three you've already seen, but I think the fourth bullet point is that decreased fat oxidation due to feedback control by redox states on beta oxidation, and the difference in redox equivalence feeding into complex 1 or complex 2, 1 and 2 from fat, that could be a means of regulating at the ETC. What I will not spend time at in this talk, due for the interest of time, is that probably at what I believe, and I think what is evident in the literature, is that the regulation of fatty acid transport across the membrane, or sarcolemma, is probably not a major player in this attenuation. And if some of you sit and wonder why I haven't brought up malonyl-CoA and discussed that, I don't think there's evidence for a role of malonyl-CoA that would inhibit CPT1, so I don't think the evidence is there, really. So that's why I haven't brought up. So I think these are the key mechanistic explanations for what is the what is causing the attenuation of fat oxidation moving from moderate to high intensity exercise. A few other comments on this, which is with slightly different focus. One, I think one of the aspects that's worthwhile mentioning here is that if we use different models, all of these studies that you saw here before, and most of the studies in the literature on this area is done on young, very well-trained males. This model has the advantage that it's easy to study what happens across a limited muscle mass exercising. So if you use this model, and we did that some 10 years ago, published a work where we had measured leg fat oxidation using AV techniques at rest in 25, 65, and 80% of U2 Vmax, approximately trying to get the same oxygen utilization in per muscle mass as you would see during whole body exercise, and that requires a lot of assumptions that we can discuss. Using this model, you can see that there's no difference in fat oxidation across these three exercise intensities. And that would indicate that in a situation where you are exercising at a similar oxygen utilization, but not the same hormonal, obviously, environment, you would not see a limitation to muscle fat oxidation or leg fat oxidation, if you like. And that would that implicates that when there is sufficient delivery of oxygen, sufficient delivery of substrate, probably not a limitation on the endogenous stores, then there's no attenuation or maximal fat oxidation. So that is worthwhile remembering when we actually talk about the mechanisms that is governing this. Another point is a study that we published some years ago, and not really, the main focus here are twofold. This is in obese and former obese and control subjects, and this is a progressive incremental exercise test where we measured maximal fat oxidation using indirect calorimetry. Basically what you see here is the arm cranking, relative workload of V2 max arm and relative workload of leg. And what I would like to draw your attention to is that the level up here from the obese and the post-obese is 0.4 grams per minute, whereas during arm exercise, it's 0.25. So there's clearly a difference on what model you use and what type of exercise that I used. And the other aspect of it that I think is worthwhile mentioning is that you've just seen studies that show that the peak or the maximal fat oxidation occurs at 60 or 65% of U2 max. And there's some very good evidence that came out of Asger Jorgendrup's lab many years ago. But when we look on sort of more normal subjects that are not very trained, you can see that for the arms, it's down below 40, and up here, it's probably at below 50, and for the controls here, it's below 40. So that's also something that you have to consider. It may not be that the mechanisms are identical when we operate with these, I think there's a lack in the literature focusing on this. It's possible that mechanisms are the same, but we don't really know that. Finally, I'd like to just share with you some unpublished data. And what we've done here is looking on maximal fat oxidation and the effects of fasting, and this is work by Jakob Fransen. And pretty much we see what is the effect of that. And he will speak later today on the coupling to performance and on a brief talk. And what we've done is simply take well-trained subjects in two occasions, one where they are fed carbohydrates with milk very early in the morning, and then at 8 o'clock, 12 o'clock, 4 o'clock, and 8 o'clock in the evening, they do an incremental progressive exercise test, as you just saw it before, where we approximately 30, 40 minutes of exercise, where we determine the maximal fat oxidation. And then the group they are fed here, approximately the amount of energy expended, so we can maintain plasma glucose and glycogen, and the other group just keeps fasting. And if we look on these, you can see here the subject characteristic, and you see that 10 males, they are a fairly well-trained bunch of guys and with a reasonable low body fat. And this is the picture of what we see when this is relative intensity on both sides, and this over here is the fed state and here's the fastest state. If we can quantify this into actually bars, you can see here the two first tests, the two at noon, the one in the early afternoon and the one in the evening. And as I said, we expect that there is a significant increase in maximal fat oxidation with fasting, and whereas it slightly decreased when they were fed. Not surprising, but very nice that this was what we had hoped for, and this was what we actually saw. And we had blood samples in the morning, and not surprising really, you can see when they're in the fed state, this is the first, second, third, and fourth test, you can see that the plasma fatty acids are low, and they remain low, whereas in the fasted state, they are higher than up here, and they increase to about twice the amount, and they're fairly high here in late evening after having not had any food for a whole day. Slight ketosis on the beta-hydroxybutyrate here from comparing to the morning, and markedly higher than up here. And what I really wanted to show, actually, and the reason why I brought these data, is this graph, which depicts the average of the 10 subjects on the 8 different tests. So this was a crossover test, obviously. So here what you see is maximal fat oxidation in grams per minute, and you can see the plasma fatty acid concentration. And there's a very, very strong correlation, albeit this is the total average of the subjects. So it's a very strong correlation. Again, speaking to the fact that at maximal fat oxidation, clearly the plasma fatty acid has a role to play. As I alluded to before on the early slides, based by mine and also Bendikin's data, probably not a large role, but it is there. And also with the one-leg data, where you saw that fat oxidation was not limited. So basically, that is worthwhile mentioning. So to sum up, so the plasma fatty acid availability, probably not the major determinant. The free carnitine and probably less likely muscle pH is one of the central mechanisms attenuating fat oxidation. Possibly decreased availability of the coenzyme A and possibly working via the intermitochondrial CoA on inhibition of CPT2. The effect on the redox state on the complex intermitochondrial membrane is theoretically yet, but very probable. There's a difference in models that when you have oxygen availability and substrate delivery is a factor that has a role. Sarcolemma transport is probably not really important here. And as I alluded to here last, this work is mostly done in young, well-trained men, and we don't know if it's the same in women, and we don't know if it's the same when we take people that are not trained, aged, et cetera, et cetera. So there's still work to do. And with that, I'd just like to acknowledge my co-workers here and the funding, and thanks for the attention.
Thank you for a very nice overview, Jorn. We have time for some questions, please, from the floor. No, maybe I can start. In your data where you showed differences in the curves between obese and lean individuals, I think, and you were implying that there's a different regulation there. But of course, that's not comparing exercise intensities, that's comparing individuals, if you like. And I was just wondering if you corrected the obese data for mitochondrial volume, does that affect at all the shape of the curves? Because clearly fat oxidation rates will decline if mitochondrial volume is changing mm-hmm. due to deconditioning. So that's when you're comparing across disease states, maybe that is an important factor to also consider in mm-hmm. terms of the relative contribution.
That's a very good point. No, we haven't done that. What we, not by actually by intention, but by chance, the lean body mass was identical. The VO2 max was identical across these three, but obviously not when expressed per kilo body mass. The citrate synthase was also higher in the post-obese because they were probably more active. We haven't done that. And I presume probably what would happen would be that the post-obese would retain, stay higher, but the obese would probably come down to the control, something like that. That would be my guess. And we haven't measured that citrate synthase activity. We haven't really measured proper mitochondrial volume.
Okay, thank you. Another point is the problem with the redox state data is it's impossible to know what fraction of the NEDA in NEDH is actually intramitochondrial, and, yes. and then that obviously makes it difficult to interpret the data.
Yeah.
But you are right, it is a potential mechanism.
Yeah. We have to step up methodologically to address that issue. I don't see any way to study it right now, but we have to step up on that.
We'll leave that to you.
Thanks, Paul.
Okay. Thank you, Jorn.
Pleasure.